Talk Radio, you're in to all things music.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, brought to you by the Inner Talk Radio Network. Hey, guys, it's a beautiful Wednesday, February the 8th in Southern California. And I got to tell you something, man. We've been planning this since last year on Michael Jackson's actual birthday on August the 28th. But due to medical situations with Mr. Jonathan Moffett, we had to cancel. And it's been a while since we're getting this back into situation. Me being off, we're back on. So let's put the behind us behind us. And let's look forward to today. So with that said, guys, I am so proud and I'm so privileged to welcome to my show the legendary and iconic drummer since 1979 with the Jacksons. And that parlayed into the years with that and then on to Mr. Michael Jackson itself until the day of his untimely passing. So with that said, I want to welcome everybody with open ears and open arms. Please welcome to the my show, Jackie's Groove, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Jonathan, what's up, brother? How are you?
I'm trying to recover from this flu that's got me down, but I couldn't let you down the second time, so I say, sick or well, I'm going to be there.
You're a gentleman and a scholar, let me just tell you. Hey, brother, welcome, man. You know, everybody, Jonathan's got a little taste of the flu and bronchitis, but like he said, he's here, he's going to mosh it up. So if he sounds like Barry White, believe me, it is definitely Jonathan Moffett. So, hey, Jonathan, let's start out by saying, you know, thank you, brother. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Congratulations on your engagement to your beautiful fiance. And let's pick this up.
Fantastic. Now,
my wife and I think about 5-6 months ago, we were in Las Vegas and we were invited as a guest to Jonathan when Jonathan sat back on the throne with his what's the iconic group called? Cameo, Word Up. And we sat afterwards on the show and we were knocked out by it. And we went and we had a 3.5-hour dinner at Benihana's. And it was enlightening, for the lack of a better word. We talked about everything, his career and so on. So what we're going to do is we're going to duplicate that today. And we're going to talk about everything that has to do with the Jacksons and his work with Madonna, George Michael, Stevie Wonder, to name but a few. Jonathan, where were you born and where were you raised, brother?
I was born in New Orleans, Louisiana, 1954. I was raised there as well. Not until I turned 24, that's when I moved out to Los Angeles in pursuit of my dreams. You know, I grew up born there, and at 6 years old, my father came home from the post office where he worked, and he asked me and my brothers if he wanted to play music. He said yes, excitedly. And my brothers were older than I, so they got first choice. So each one said, I want to play guitar. My first brother and my father said, fine. My other brother said, I want to play guitar. My father said, no, play something different. And he wanted to play bass and saxophone. When it came to me, I said, I want to play guitar. You know, and my father said, we can't have all guitarists, you know, so you have to pick something different. The only other thing I knew was drums. So I said, all right, I'll play drums. But it turned out to be my calling. You know, I had no idea at the time.
You
and
did.
It turned out to be my calling. I grew to love playing drums after my first few lessons, and I figured out how to do something that my private teacher taught me, how to do exactly what he wanted me to do. So it gave me incentive that I can learn this, and I got excited about it. And so from 6 years old at that first lesson, private lesson, and by the time I was 9 years old, I was playing my brother's band, and we did talent shows and block parties and different things like that, you know, around in New Orleans. And every year from 6 to 9, I got a different part of the set. So what I'm saying is at 6, I got a snare drum, marching wow. snare drum. Then at 7, I got a bass drum and a cymbal. At 8, I got two rack times and a four time and then two more cymbals. At 9, you know, that's when I was playing with my brother's group. By the 10 years old, I was playing in nightclubs, making money with my brother's band. You know, the laws down there were kind of loose at the time, so they let them sneak me in the back door, as long as the police didn't see it. And I'd play the gig, set up my drums and play the gig, and then fall asleep across their lap driving home to the house. And I'd hear them talking about it. The little man did really great. He's amazing. And I would fake sleep, but I'd be listening to all the stuff they had to say. They didn't know I was faking sleep. So, and they would give me $5, and I'd say, wow, what is this for? And they said, it's paid. You get paid to do this. And I was like shocked. You get paid to do something I love so much.
Wow. So,
at 10 years old through 24, when I left New Orleans, I was with various local bands and playing all over the cities and sometimes regionally. And so we different bands that I played with my brother's right. band. When I turned 12, you know, they wanted to play more nightclubs that wouldn't let a younger guy in there. So they right. got another drummer. And so I wound up joining another band. And that didn't matter. So to them, I was so young. And that's why I got the name Sugarfoot. The leader of the band said, everybody in the band has nicknames. When he heard me play my footwork, he said, you have fast foot, a sweet foot. Well, what are we going to call you? And I'm thinking like, oh, he's going to call me Ace or Duke or something powerful, Titan. Right, oh, yeah, right. This is going to be cool. And then he said, I know what we call you. I said, what? He said, we call you Sugarfoot. I said, Sugarfoot? Oh, no, I don't want that name. That's a terrible name. You know, that's
really?
Not hokey, you know. I said, I want to be Ace or Duke or something powerful. He said, no, you got that sweet foot. You're Sugarfoot. And I said, well, I'm not going to answer you. And then he announced me. So he did. We're going to announce it anyway. So he did. And everybody got to know me as Sugarfoot more than my real name. So I had to acknowledge it eventually. You know, but I hated the name at first. But it caught on and spread to California. And then at 24, I decided to pursue my professional dreams. Because the things I saw on television, like Ringo Starr on television, different other artists, and I said, you know, I don't see that happening here. It must be somewhere else. So I chose Los Angeles and Hollywood and drove out in January 79, middle of January 79. And a month and a half later, I ran into the music director for the Jacksons. It was my very good friend, James McPhail. James right. McPhail, who was from New Orleans as well. And that story is like a miracle, a true miracle. You believe in miracles when you hear that story. But it takes too long to explain here. But when I ran
Take your time, baby. Take your time.
They had just gotten, was auditioning drummers. And so they had already been auditioning for 2 weeks. And the day I ran into him was the last day of the auditions. So I asked him, could he get them to extend it, give me a chance? And he did.
Mm-hmm.
And the next day, I showed up at mother's house, auditioned, and they liked me. And that started everything else in my career and in my history, my resume. You know, it's that one thing. Other people would see me with the Jacksons and call, like Cameo. Saw me with the Jacksons in Atlanta at the Omni Theater. And Larry Blackman called me. And they had the new songs, Be Yourself, and some other hit songs
right.
just come out. And I was in my car listening. I said, man, I wish I could play with Cameo. They are funky, man. I like their music and I like the beats. But the drummer is the leader of the band, and he's the drummer and the singer. So I said, there's no way I can play with Cameo. So you had things work out. 2 weeks later, my phone rings at home, and that was Larry Blackman calling me to play with Cameo. And I said, it's almost like prophetic, like I wished it and willed it into being. Larry said, I love you to play with Cameo. You were incredible with the Jacksons and stuff. And
right.
he said, I want you to play with us. And I said, well, you're the drummer. He said, start laughing. He said, no, I'm not the drummer anymore. I'm up front singing. So that's how my 35-year journey with Cameo started. And the same thing with Madonna was at Dodger Stadium when the Jacksons, we did the victory tour, 1984. And she was there and told her manager, who was sitting next to her, who managed the Jacksons when I joined them. She said, that's my drummer. That's my drummer. He told me the story. He related the story to me. He said, that's my drummer. It's my drummer. He said, well, that's good because I already got his number from when I was managing the Jacksons, so I can contact him. So I did doing the 85 Virgin tour, my first tour with her. And after that, I did the True Blue album. And I wound up doing the Dick Tracy film soundtrack. I wound up doing the Who's That Girl tour in 87. I wound up doing the Like a Prayer album, including the songs, about the 5-6 songs on that album, including Like a Prayer. I wound up doing her Blind Ambition tour in 1990. So a lot of my work has come from people seeing me with other people. And I never had a manager. I never had an agent in my entire 38-year career. And people wonder how I do all of these things and how my resume reads how it does. So I said that I never had a manager and I never had an agent. But in reality, that's not so true. I always tell people my manager is God.
Right.
And I tell people my agent is Jesus Christ. And that's why my resume reads the way it does, because I had the highest manager you can have and I had the highest agent you can have. So that's how my resume reads how it does, because everything pretty much came to me.
Jonathan, let me step back for a second here. Let's go back to your times with the Jacksons. And you talked about your friend being the manager at the time and so on and so forth. But let's talk about the day that you were actually there. You got the gig with the Jacksons. Tell me and tell my listeners about that day when the Jacksons actually joined you guys for rehearsals. What went through your mind? Explain that to my listeners.
First of all, when my friend called me, James McPhill called me about 11:30 at night, good friend James, and said, Sugarfoot, they decided to give you a chance and be at mother's house at 3:00 tomorrow afternoon. I was in shock, and I wanted to call my mother, from the time I ran into him, and he told me that he's going to try to, because that day was the last day of auditions, and they had somebody coming in then. So he said, I'm not sure if they're going to like this person or what, but they've been asking the audition in 2 weeks, and they're not sure on the guys who they've heard of thus far. So he said, there's a chance, but I don't know. I can't promise you. So when he called me that night and told me I had to be at mother's house at 3:00, I was super elated. I wanted to call my mother beforehand and right. tell her. I was so excited, but I said, no, what if I don't get it? So I waited.
Exactly.
So I got a chance. But so the next day I got there, and it was at Havenhurst, which is the Ponderosa, so to speak. So they have a studio in the back in the big garage complex. Mm-hmm. And a real recording studio, not just a homemade studio, it was a real recording studio. So we rehearsed in there, we auditioned in there. So I had Johnny Jackson's drums was in there, because my drum set wasn't that great to do that. So I played on Johnny Jackson's set, and they asked me to play. They were excited to meet me. They were a little bit suspect, and looking right. at me like they didn't know about that. But then they decided, okay, let's play some songs. And Tito was talking mostly. He said, I want you back. It may not be in this order, but it's sort of like this. He said, I want you back. And I said, yeah, I know it, because little did they know I was a fan of theirs, just like every other kid back in the days, and I learned all this stuff. So we played I Want You Back, and then he said, Stop Your Love, You Save. We played that song. We played ABC. He said, ABC, so I played that song. They were like, that's pretty good. Because I learned them like the record, when I used to learn things just like the record. So they were pretty like impressed, and he was like shaking his head, that's pretty good. Then the clincher for the audition for Every Drummer was, okay, well, you can play all that stuff. You did pretty good. You sound pretty good. He said, now, this one, we're going to see if you can play this one. Do you know Shake Your Body Down to the Ground? I said, yeah, I know that. I said, yeah, I can play that. They all started looking at each other and mumbling and whispering, and they say, wow. I said, he said, Shake Your Body Down to the Ground? I said, yeah, I know that beat. He said, you know it. You can play it. I said, yes, I can. But little did he know, when I was still in New Orleans around 76, no, not 76, about 78, right before I came there, and they released that song. It was a big hit, of course. And I was doing some production work with a producer at Alan Toussaint's studio. Alan Toussaint's a legendary New Orleans producer.
Right.
And I was at one of his understudy producers. I was doing a song, and he wanted to put some girl artist he was developing. And he wanted to straight out rip off Shake Your Body Down to the Ground. And the way I was raised, yes, he went straight out, ripped it off. And I was like, the way I was raised, you don't do that, Kevin. You don't steal. The way I was raised, you don't steal. You can't do that. And plus, you get in trouble. So, go to jail if you steal. I was always taught that kind of stuff. So,
right.
Anyway, he said, that. I said, I know that. That producer asked me if I knew it. I said, yeah, I could play it. I knew it, but I was fearful of getting in trouble, getting arrested. I don't know. I was just naive. I thought I'd get arrested if they found out I played on it. So when we started to record it, I said, I got to change something up so we won't know that it's I've sold it. So I said, let's record it. Now, this is the producer in New Orleans. Little did the Jackson know all of this happened. So we started recording, and then I said, I know I'm going to change up the hi-hat pattern, make it a little bit different so it won't be a straight-out rip-off. So we started recording, and then I played it different. And then he said, wait, cut, cut. He said, cut. You know, that's Jonathan. I thought you said you knew that beat. I said, I do know that beat. He said, well, play, that's not the right hi-hat part. I said, oh, it's not? And I was like playing like I wouldn't know. He said, oh, let's play it again. So I said, man, he's on to me. He realized I played a different hi-hat part. I'll change something else. So he said, do you know how to, let's play it again. The next time I changed up the time patterns in that song. And he said, cut, cut, cut. Come in here. Everybody come in here. He said, Jonathan, I thought you knew how to play that song. You said you know how to play it. I said, I do. He said, why are you not playing it right? That's not the beat. I said, because if I play it right, like they have on a record, I'll get in trouble and I'll go to jail. That's for stealing. The whole place erupted into laughter and they start cracking up at me and saying, you know, he said, no, I tell you what. If the police come, I was really naive back then. He said, if the police come, tell them I told you to play that beat and they'll arrest me. But I'll go to jail. You won't go to jail. I said, oh, yeah. I said, okay. So I went in there, played it, and he's on the talk back. And he said, yeah, that's it. So I knew how to play it from that session in that time. And Tito and the Jacksons didn't know that story.
Very cool.
But when I told him I could play that beat, they were just shocked and couldn't believe it. So at the audition, he said, okay, let's play Shake Your Body Down. Tito says that. I said, okay, let's play it. We started playing it, and then I started playing that beat. Tito got this puzzled look on his face, and I looked around the room, Randy looking at Jackie, and Jackie looking at this and all, and they all like puzzled, and like I'm like thinking though, but I'm thinking like this, oh my God, what am I doing wrong? They all like shocked. I must be messing it up really bad. You know, what am I doing? Maybe I figured it out wrong. And then Tito, about a minute into it, Tito said, wait, stop. And they was all whispering and mumbling with each other, and they said, then Randy came over and said, hold on, laughing and smiling, hold on. And I said to myself, he's laughing at me. I must be really screwing it up. But I knew I had it right. So Randy came around the side of the drum and said, wait, Sugarfoot, play that beat again. Just you. So I played it again, and he's looking at me, he's leaning over at me, looking at my hands, my feet. And then he puts his hand on his face and then ran his head back and said, oh, no. And I'm like, saying, what? I'm best. Am I playing it wrong? He said, no, play it slower. Now, a lot of people don't know Randy's a drummer, too. So he said, play it slower. I started playing it slower. Then he grabbed his face again and said, oh, man, I can't believe this. I said, what, am I playing it wrong? He said, no, Foot, you don't understand. That beat on the record was a three-part overdub. The guy,
Jonathan, do me a favor, brother. I'm going to interrupt you real quick, or we're going to lose this segment. Pick this up when we pick up on segment number two, because this is crazy. So don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be right back after this break, going from number one into number two with the iconic and legendary drummer from the Jacksons, Madonna, George Michael, to name but a few, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Guys, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on Intertalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday at 2 p.m.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Everybody, welcome back. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, brought to you by the almighty Intertalk Radio Network. You guys, that was the funky sticks of my in-studio guest today, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Jonathan, I'm going to tell you something, man. You know, they say there's always 6 degrees of separation and how things come around and so on. I've always said the fact that, you know, I look back in the history of, all my longevity with the Beach Boys and knowing that I grew up literally 10 minutes away from them as a child. And then moving fast forward, my wife and I, we used to live in Tustin Ranch. And that was your stomping ground. And I would always see Jonathan hanging out at the Irvine Spectrum, either at P.F. Chang's or whatever it was. And I knew him and he knew me, but we just, you know, we'd always see each other. We'd always talk and we'd always chop it up. And let's step back even further. Back in 1984, I was at Dodger Stadium with my wife, my dear friend Al Lewis, and his girlfriend at the time with the Jacksons live in concert backstage. It was absolutely amazing. So it's funny when you come back and how everything is brought back to 1984 when we first saw the Jacksons to 2017 and on my show with the Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Now, Jonathan, going back for a second, we left on that last break. We talked about how you didn't want to rip off the certain sounds out there and so on, and being a naive kid and how you started playing again with the Jacksons and so on. And pick up where we left off and talk to the audience again about what was going on during that time.
Yeah, to pick up, it was like when Randy came behind the set to see, and he asked me to play Shake Your Body Down to the Ground again. And right. He's like, oh my God. And I'm saying, I must be playing it wrong. And everybody was like in shock look on their face. And like, they was, I don't know, just had faces looking like they were, it was almost like displeasure, but actually it was disbelief. So, but Randy said, play it again, slower. So I started playing the beat slower. And then he grabbed his face and turned around and ran back and said, right. Oh my God. I say, what's wrong? Am I playing it wrong? You say, no, Foot. You don't understand. When we recorded that beat, there was a three-part overdub. The drummer couldn't play it all at one time, so we did it three parts. We did the basic beat with the kick snare and hat. Then we went back on the overdub, and we played that. They did the hi-hat part. It was a triplet kind of thing with, and the open at the end. Then we went back, and we added the time parts. And then we mixed it all together, and that became that beat. At three parts that were done separately. Here you are playing it all at one time, because the other guys, nobody that came for the audition could play it like that, and it always leaves something off. But the way you're doing it, you don't leave anything off. How did you figure that out? I said, well, I just looked at the picture, the pattern, with how it had to happen in my mind, but I was actually ignorant to the fact that there was a three-part overdub that was in New Orleans. I figured he had to cross here, he had to cross that way to make this happen without losing the hi-hat part or anything. So they were all in disbelief in the studio, and they would start laughing and talking. And I said, did I mess up? He said, no, you're doing it perfect right. And then that's when they said, Foot, you're our drummer. And I said, wow, thank you so much. Thank you very much. And so I was in disbelief. Now I'm playing with the Jacksons. So then he said, my father wants to talk to you. And he said, so afterwards, that was it. That's one song, Chris did. And I went out in the yard, walking around Havenhurst in the yard, with talking with their father. Talk about some business and stuff. He said, my son's really like you. My son. And Jackie said, you know, he looks like us. He looks like one of us. And I remember Jackie saying that. He looks like one of us. And he said, Foot, you could tell him you're our cousin. You could tell him you're our cousin. You look like one of us. Like we did with Johnny. I said, okay, yes, okay. So I never did because I don't want to lie. So I was also trying to make my own legacy, my own career, you know, not based on built on lies or stuff like that, a deception. So I want to give Moffett his own name in the industry. So anyway, I talked to Joseph walking around the yard, and it was a pleasant conversation and talk business and everything. But he said, my sons really like you. He said, you want to play with my sons? And I said, yeah, I'd love to play with your sons. He said, okay, well, then you're hired. You're on board. And that was only 3 days. I had 3 days to learn the whole entire show, my first professional show ever. I had 3 days to learn the whole show. And then we went out, left Havenhurst and three Winnebagoes, motorhomes. And we went out to do the first shows, drove across country to Cleveland, Ohio. And we did our first show in Cleveland.
Hey, Jonathan, step back for 1 second. You know, let's talk about today's production on stage-wise. And when it comes back to backtracking and DAT recordings and so on to beef up the sound, let's go back to, you know, to the beginning, 79, 80, in the early days. There was no backtracking back then itself. So whatever you guys put on vinyl, you had to reproduce on stage. And, you know, we didn't have in-ear monitors. We had the big monitors itself. When you had to produce something on the stage that was on the record to make it sound verbatim, was that a problem for you at all? Or you had enough chops back then that you were able to handle everything on stage along with the big band that backed the Jacksons?
I never, ever had a problem with that. I listened very intently because I don't know if the listening public knows or doesn't know, but I don't read music. I was self-taught. I had no teacher in my neighborhood.
Likewise.
I had nobody. Only my private teacher taught me on snare drum, the basic rhythms of rudiments, mm-hmm. you know. But then when I got in the school bands and the concert bands and stuff, I read then snare drum only because I always did snare drum. As far as drum set, it was just a desire and inspiration. You know, the people, my idols on record, wanted to play those, that kind of music. So just practicing from room to room in my mother's home.
Right.
Setting up the drum set, listening to vinyls. And of course, as you know, with vinyl, if you mess up, you can't get it. You got to get off the drum set, go back over to the record player, put the needle back, and then run back to the drum set to catch it in time before it starts. So that craziness, but it was worth it to me. And I wanted to challenge this, and I wanted to conquer and learn these beats and songs. It meant a lot to me. I was dedicated and devoted. So that got me to the point where I could absorb things in a deeper, more intently way that it compensated for my non-reading or not being able to read, inefficiency of reading. So I listened extremely intently to what's happening to all the parts, and I deciphered it out and worked it out. So I was never challenged by it. As long as I could hear the parts, I could replicate it, given a little time to work it out, know where to cross, where, what to do, whatever. So one of my things is, everybody says that I can play three or four parts at one time. That would be a overdone part, you know. So I just figured out how to do that, you know. Just one of my things I can do, and basically it's called. I mean, I call it replicating what I hear. So it doesn't matter how they did it on record. I replicated. It's like a copy machine. You make a copy, you got a copy of it. So in my mind, I just made copies of every element of the drum set that I heard, and I figured out how to cross when and where to make it happen. And it's just a scientific way of just working it out, picturing it and deciphering where I got to cross the hands to make that happen without losing anything. That's the key, without losing any beats. That's the key. You know,
and to all the kids out there, listen to what Mr. Moffett is talking about. This is butt-ass kicking 101. I mean, you know, things are different today, man. You can push a button and make things happen. But back then, it's, you know, you had to build that foundation before you built that house. And the fact is, I think a lot of young artists today are – They haven't built that house. They're, you know, or I should say they haven't set that foundation. And, you know, and it's learned, man. We learned this itself. You know, I'm a non-reading and non-writing musician myself. I think we gain a sixth sense when we don't read it on paper. You know, we have to pick it up. We have to, it's like a gentleman that was born without sight. Your other senses, you get, you know, they get stronger. And so with that said, you know, when you're going on and you're playing it and you're adding your own taste to it, but at the same time too, you're instructed to play it like the record. And that's a good little segue here, because people, the listening audience out there, you have to understand one thing. Mr. Moffett was the driving force for the live Jackson / Michael Jackson situation. It's my good friend, Jonathan's good friend, and good friends, J.R. Robinson, who did the majority of the recording for Michael's music on vinyl, on cassette, on CD, and also Mr. Indigo Chancellor. And, you know, and so we're so proud and we're privileged, man, here on Intertalk Radio, that we have encompassed all of the great players that actually played on the soundtrack of our lives. And with that said, Jonathan, let me ask you a question. Playing with the Jacksons, that had to be mind-blowing in itself, because you weren't playing in, you know, in front of, you know, 2,000 people. You were playing in this case, like I said, Dodger Stadium. It was a packed house. Do you, as a musician, as a drummer, do you have a preference? Because I noticed the difference of size-wise with Michael versus seeing you in Las Vegas with Cameo in such a smaller room. Does it matter to you, the size of the crowd? Does that motivate you, or does it not make a difference at all?
Doesn't make a difference at all. I'm going to give everything I have, no matter if there's two people in the audience, if there's 100,000 people in the stadium. Doesn't Perfect. Make a difference at all. I give my soul for my music, my performance, for the show itself, for the songs itself, and for my own gratification of trying to be perfect, trying to play it right, trying to make people feel it, you know, with my emotions, my feel, my attitude I put on the beats. Now, like right. I said, JR, and you left that one, Jeff Vaccaro, and Dugu. They all gave me the template to build on and to work from, which was some amazing work that they've done. You know, what I did to those songs live wouldn't have been that way if Jeff wouldn't have put his soul into what he did and got captured on that record. If Ndugu wouldn't have put his soul into what he did and his touch and his feel, and Jeff Vaccaro wouldn't have put his touch and feel and soul into it. They gave me a template to work from. I added my live energy. You know, I always approach drumming from a rock drummer. I always admired the rock drummers that play with such intense power, at least the power rock drummers, not the glam rock, but the power rock drummers impressed me with the depth of emotion and power that they gave. So I decided way early on in my life and career, in my teens, I'm going to add that power, because I love rock music as well. I add that power and intensity to funk and soul music, and that's where part of my vibe and playing comes through. I play with extreme intensity and precision because I feel it that way. So I had that with Jeff done and with John done and with Ndugu's done. I had that because it's live, is a different environment than the record. So I play it like they did on the record, but I add the intensity of my emotion, my touch, my feel, and I had a few slick things in there, colors here and there to make it more expressive live and a little bit different to make it transform a little bit better live. So, but I had really good templates to work on.
You know, Jonathan, I got to test them. You know what? You know, other than your intensity and your power on stage, just the visual itself. But I got to tell you, you know what I'm really impressed with is that our mature age. For the people that haven't seen Jonathan in Las Vegas with Cameo at the Westgate Resort, Jonathan has to climb about 18 stairs, a ladder, to get up to his perch, and that was to me and my wife just awe-inspiring. That I'm watching this man like Spider-Man crawling up the stage. Does that ever get scary for you, brother? Because you are on top of that perch. What's that like overlooking black men and everybody else?
Well, at first it was very scary. You know, I said, I got to climb up there. Oh, man, I'm not going to do that. Then finally realized I had to do it because, you know, I took on the job. So I was very tentative in climbing the stairs. It was really, really scary. I was holding on for dear life. So, but after a few shows and a few times, I got used to it. And I just learned where to grab and where to hold on and squeeze my hands tight. And before I move my foot from one stair to another, make sure my hands are planted tight and hold on tight. And I move the next foot up. And then the thing, when you get up there, though, my drum set is not the biggest set I use, but it's pretty elaborate. But there was no space on the top of that riser for anything. So I have to basically do like Cirque du Soleil transforming in body transformation to squeeze through. There and get to the seat. So it's tricky that way too, because my stomach and my face and my back is rubbing into cymbals and is that tight. And then I try to get there safely without falling backwards. That's a little tough, but now I'm used to it. And I just try to be careful every time I go up there. Or when I come down, that's scary too, because you got to back down. You can't go straight down, of course. You got to back down and make sure your feet are planted firmly on the bars as you're climbing down on the ladder of the.
And, you know, and Jonathan, a little while ago, I asked about the size stage-wise, giving it your all, regardless if it's 10 people or 100,000. But let me just tell the listeners out there, if you get the chance, make the pilgrimage to Las Vegas. Cameo has not lost a lick. And let me tell you, an audience of that smaller size has just as much energy as an audience of 100,000. Johnny, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Jonathan, that is the funkiest crowd that I've ever seen in my life. You know, I mean, they're up on their feet from the beginning. And especially when you hear that on that's my worst impersonation of Word Up. But the fact of the matter is when that song kicks off and Candy and such, it is absolutely amazing.
Yeah. This band, like you said, this band hasn't lost anything. This band hasn't lost anything for decades. It's just as strong as ever. And every individual on the stage is basically a fusion musician. You know, fusion musicians play. We all play complicated stuff, real complicated. But to make money and to be successful, they simplify what they have, you know, they can do to make simplified songs that sell records. You know, so. But they all, you know, at the top of their game, you know, they pro us up there, whatever the position you have, guitar, bass, you know, and stuff. So, and the singers are great as well. So, the band hasn't lost anything. If anything else, it's stronger, tighter, more powerful. And for some reason, God has blessed me and gave me more power, more strength and power than I've had ever in my life. For some reason, I can play stronger and harder than I've ever played. For some reason, I'm just thankful. I don't question it. I'm just grateful and thankful that I can. And as long as I can, I will.
You know, I got a message just now from a listener by the name of Alphonse Lewis. He had mentioned to me the fact that he was actually in Las Vegas last weekend, but you guys were the stage was dark. When are you guys going back there?
Next week, next Thursday. We dark this week. We got an outside show, I think in Iowa on Saturday. Then we go back on next Thursday and start again.
You know, and for the listeners out there, we're going back and forth. When you're sitting here talking to an icon like Mr. Moffett, you know, you got to go back and forth. There's 1,000 different notes out there. I mean, I want to talk more about the fact of working with Madonna, you know, and how that was. I have a good friend of mine, Ron Powell, who actually had the percussion chair probably about 15 years ago. I didn't have a lot of great things to say about the band at the time, but really, really loved her. So with that said, we're going to pick it up again here on the segment number 3. Jonathan is blowing by right now. We're trailing off of 2. And I want to talk to you more about the untimely passing of Mr. George Michael and how that was working with him and also along with Stevie Wonder and the other luminaries that you've been blessed with. So with that said, guys, if you have any other questions, please go online to intertalkradio.com and go into our live chat. Any questions you have for Mr. Moffett, we'll definitely place it to him and we'll go ahead and have it answered for you accordingly. And you know, if you guys missed the show today live, wouldn't be listening to this, obviously, but you can also listen to our show on intertalkradio.com or jackiesgroove.com. Go on to Episodes on Demand in about 2 hours, and you'll see the listing for Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. So with that said, guys, we're going to be trailing out of 2 into 3 with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett, Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, Intertalk Radio Network. Guys, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after this short break. Trust me, you don't want to go anywhere. This is it.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on Intertalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element, affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InnerTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Everybody, welcome back. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, brought to you by Intertalk Radio. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett, who has graced the stages with the who's who in the industry. And that song, Jonathan, what was the genesis of that tune? I don't know that song.
Well, that's Richard Marx. He's one of my favorite songwriters and producers. I worked on three albums with Richard Marx. You know, Rush Street and The Paid Vacation. And what's the other one I did? I did three albums with him. I can't remember the third one that I did. But anyway, so that was one of the songs from that album. And Randy Jackson, the bass player, but he's also was on American Idol.
Right.
Randy Jackson, he produced that track. So he played bass on a lot of the stuff that I did with Richard Marx.
Oh, man, he's a great, I mean, that was one of the greatest. The guy had the best hair in the industry, let me just tell you at the time. You know, and yeah. But I want to go back for a second here, man, because when we sat down at Benihana's in Las Vegas for 3.5 hours, you shared some amazing, amazing stories. And I told you going in, I don't like to do any pre-interviews at all. I like everything to be raw. But that was 3.5 hours of probably the most awe-inspiring information that you shared with us, you know. And we'll talk more about that if you so choose to do so, because the listeners want to know about the situation the day. I know exactly where we were the day that Michael passed. I mean, I can remember it like it was yesterday, one of our favorite restaurants out here where I live. And but when you sat there and you told Caprice myself how it led up to that situation, we're going to get to that, because we've lost too many amazing entertainers, Prince, and recently George Michael and so on. How was it working with George Michael? Tell my listeners about that.
It was a beautiful experience working with George. When I went over there, I met him backstage with Elton John. Elton John, we played in London at Wembley Arena, and George Michael was there. And after the show, I got to say hi to him when we came off of getting ready to go for the encore. He was standing back there behind stage, and he complimented me immediately. He said, "You sound fantastic. It was amazing." But little did I know that he was checking it out, and 2 years later, he would call me for his tours. So that goes to show you, whatever you're playing or whatever you're doing, you got to give 110%, because you don't know who's in the audience. I mean, your next work may be sitting in that audience. And so, and you can impress them, and then you have work with them. So he asked me to play, and, you know, I got the call to play with George Michael, and I was really excited. Oh my God, this is incredible. So of course I accepted it. I went to London to rehearse, you know, and I met a whole new bunch of friends, people that became friends. So it was me, you know, because all these situations, when you join another new situation, you wind up also making friends, new friends.
Right.
So it's people that you work with, new peers and new friends. And that's a good part about it. So So I started working with him. He was so easy going, and he trusted what you do because you're there. You know, give a little guidance here and there on a specific song, but other than that, he didn't trust that you do. You want to give him what he wants. So he was so easy going, man, so laid back, so calm spirited.
What year was this, Jonathan?
This was 1991. You know, and we did the cover tour. Where he did a bunch of cover songs. That the song mm-hmm. that impressed him and inspired him to become an artist. So he honored the artist that inspired him to become an artist. So he would pick certain songs from each artist and put it together, and then mix in his songs as well amongst them. So that's why he called it Cover to Cover Tour. So it was a great experience, and you know, of course, he had an incredible following. It was packed at every place we played, super packed. And at the time, I knew George could sing, but I didn't know he could sing like that. On the songs I didn't play on, I would stand on the side of the stage. I mean, one or two songs where he just sang, just him and his vocal and his fans that loved him. And he just one-on-one related to them. So I would stand on the side of the stage and marvel at the timbre of his voice and the tone and the true tone and spirit and the soul and the feeling that he could sing with. And I had become a fan, you know, at that moment. This guy can really sing. He can't just sing. He can sing. So,
exactly.
You know, he became way more respected to me. And what he was able to do, you know, and I see why Aretha and all these other artists wanted to sing with him. So it was a wonderful experience for me, and a first class, you know, first class in every way aspect of it, you know. So I had one of the most wonderful times of my career with him. Then we did the Rock and Rio Festival in 1992 down there in Brazil.
And, Jonathan, so, I don't want to sound naive, but what was your feelings when you heard of his passing?
Utter shock. What a shock. What people don't know is I was scheduled to do this new tour he's going to do this year. He was reforming Wham the first time since the 80s. And I was in touch. I had already been in touch with Dion Estes, the bass player. And he told me, the bassist for that. Dion Estes was the bassist for Wham as well with George. They started Wham and together. And so I was already contacted to do that. He's going to do a new album and then a new tour, and it's going to be a recorded and filmed documentary for, I think it's over Showtime, one of the cable stations. All that stuff was planned for this year, and we had already been talking about it. It's coming up, and his manager, Michael Lippman. So I was set to do that with him this year. But that's not what bothered me. It's bothered me is really hurt me, bothered me. I lost another good, dear friend, somebody with a beautiful spirit, a very kind person, very important in my life. And I was looking so much forward to being back with him because he tried to get me back with him back in 1993 and 94 when I was with Janet Jackson. He called me, and his people called me, but I couldn't get out of that contract. Of course, I wouldn't leave Janet, but still, he called me to try to get me back with him then. Then he tried to get me back with him a second time when I was with Michael on a history tour. He called and tried to get me back, come back to him. But of course, I couldn't leave Michael, so I was on a contract. So then, I was up for this thing. So I'd always been looking forward to working with him because I love his music, and the songs were fun and great to play. And he was just a kind, really nice spirit.
Was Carlos Rios playing guitar at that time?
Yeah.
Like I thought so.
Carlos was. Yeah.
Hey, man, it's a small world all the way around. Hey, you know, Jonathan, you know, a lot of people don't know about you and Michael. I know this only because you shared this with us. But you and Michael were actually tighter than Michael was with a lot of his own brothers. Correct me if I'm wrong?
Yeah. Yes, he was. Because Michael and I were like spirits, like recognizing like. So we recognized ourselves spiritually, even before we say a word. You know, when we first started working with him, I could tell we had very similar spirits and mindsets. And then when we started talking, a lot of things we came to realize that we were that way, you know. And so we related more and tighter. And he wanted to be even closer to me, but you know, it was like this whole thing. Like, you know, I see, well, people are trying to always get time out of the families, the brothers and Michael's life and take up their time going to hang out with them at the house. Cause I was always welcome at the house. Mother says, you can always ring the bell. I was like, you can come in. We open the gates for you anytime you want, anytime. But so she said, we own the gates, but I knew and figured from talking to the musical at the time, everybody's trying to get time with them. And they had no real personal family time. So I was just of the mindset, like I said, I was like Michael in a lot of ways. I love the mindset where I said, you know what, if I go over there too, I'll be taking a little time that they had left from them being a family. So I would never go or call, you know, I could show I had the right and was given the permission to do so, but I just never did because it would be just another person taking up private time they would have that they have left to spend with them being a family. So I never did chase it down. Even Michael said, call me, we get together, come on, buy this thing. I just didn't do it, you know, that much, you know, because out of respect for their time, because everybody was trying to get to the Jacksons and be close to them. And some, a lot of people, unfortunately, use them and get something out of them. That's what Michael once told me. And I felt good about it because it's the truth. He said, Foot, you've been with us all these years, and you never asked us for anything or asked us for anything. You know, you've really, truly been devoted, and you never wanted anything from us. He said, that's really, really nice. We don't think the brothers don't recognize that. We all appreciate it. When you don't know we're talking about you, we're talking about you, and we all recognize that. You never, ever asked us for anything, money or anything. So we recognize that because everybody else tried to get something out of us. Mm-hmm. They try to be close to us to get something out of us. So he said, I just wanted to let you know we recognize that. You don't know we know it, but we recognize that. We appreciate you and we appreciate that you don't want us for the reasons, you know, that you want us for the wrong reason. You just want to be close to us. You feel like family. You're like family. You can come by anytime. Because we, in all those years, you never did that.
Foot, let me ask you this question, brother. Let me ask you this question real quick. You know, you mentioned that the fact and so on. I mean, one of your first aha moments was when you were hired by the Jacksons. Step back for a second, and I want you to think for a second. What was your feelings? Again, another naive question. When you got Michael's gig, not the Jacksons, but actual Michael Jackson. What was that feeling and how did that gig come to you? Was it through management? Was it through Michael directly? Share with us.
Okay, I was rehearsing at the time in 1996 with the Isley Brothers. You know, maybe not, people don't know I worked with the Isley Brothers for a very short period of time. That's only because during the rehearsals, the last week of rehearsals for the Isley Brothers, Michael's musical director called me one night, or 11 or something at night when I got back from rehearsals. And out of the blue, I had no clue. And he called me and said that Michael wants you. Say, look,
is that great?
I'm a musical director, Michael. I know that was Brad Buxer at the time. Michael, he was a MD on a Dangerous Tour and on the History Tour. Mm-hmm. And he said, I don't know who you are. I don't know who you are. Never met you before. You know, he said, but I'm calling on behalf of Michael Jackson. And of course, my whole senses lit up. Like, oh, whoa. You know, here we go. And as he said, I don't know who you are and everything. And I don't know why he wants you so much. But Michael said to call you and get you to come back to him. He wants you back to come back to him. He wants you back. And I said, well, really? I couldn't believe how this was. I said, really? Seriously? Yeah. And Michael wants you to say, look, Sugarfoot, let me tell you straight. He needs you. He said he needs you. He said, I'm going to tell you honestly. I don't know you, so I don't know how you play or anything about you, but I was trying to get my guys in there. They said, and I got one of my guys in there, and we did the Dubai, and it didn't work out. Michael was totally unhappy. So he said, call Foot. I only want Foot. And he said, I tried to plead with Michael. Just give me another chance. I got another guy. I know you like this guy. Michael said, no, I want Foot. I got to have Foot. He's the only one. And he said, I kept pushing Michael through, and Michael was very adamant. He said, look, call Foot. You know, I don't care what he wants. You know, get him back. He told me he could write his own check. So he said, Michael told me I could write my own check. You know, he said, Michael said he needs you really bad. So I'm thinking, I'm going to get out of this Isley Brothers thing because I already committed to it. It wasn't a contract, paper thing, but it was my word. So I had to go to rehearsal the next day and tell Ronald Isley, you know, leader of them, that what happened. But he said, Jonathan, Nick, he called me Jonathan, said him and his wife, was there, and he said, Jonathan, I know that's family for you. He said, my only concern is, who am I going to get to replace you? We love you here. We want you to stay with us, of course, but we know that's family with, you know, for you. And you got history with their family, and we know we can't pay you what they pay you, but he pays you. So he said, but we have to find somebody to take, you know, take your place. So he wound up finding somebody. I did a switch over. And I wound up going to Michael's rehearsals, you know, and got back with him very happily, you know, and it was a different camp of people, you know. Michael was the same, of course, but a lot of different new faces. Some of the same, David Williams, Michael's iconic guitarist, you know, and the bass, Freddie Washington was on bass. I knew Freddie, but the other keyboard players, I didn't know Brad, the music director. I didn't know the other keyboard player, two people that I didn't. I knew Jennifer. I never played with, that's how with Jennifer, but I knew of her, of course, you know.
Right.
So it was both a new and old experience, but I was happy to be back with Michael. I knew his material. I've been following all his stuff, you know, and I just had to learn the new stuff. And that was for pleasure in itself. So it was a wonderful experience. And it's always, you know, you always say, well, it's incredible when you get to call first time for a gig for somebody.
Right.
Well, no, it's more. No, I disagree. It's more incredible, more pleasurable when you get called back. That means you're doing something right. They really appreciate you. So the callbacks mean more than the first initial call, you know, so that means he's happy with you. So that's what Brad related to me, Michael said. And I worked it out with the Isleys, and then I transferred my drums over to Michael's rehearsal. And I wound up doing a couple shows, two or three shows with my Isleys first. Then I came on in, so we did the transition right. So they wound up getting somebody they really liked me to work with before. It was incredible. It was amazing. One of my heroes. So he took over for me, and I wound up going back to my old homesick, you know, with Michael. And it was an amazing tour. History tour. It was unbelievable. I'm hoping that they release it on either at the theaters or on DVD or Blu-ray at some point. You know, the state, I hope that they do that because it's something for people to see, you know. So an experience. Yeah. That was the last tour, Michael, that anybody would get to see because this is it. Never got to go out.
And we're going to talk about that, which was probably one of my favorite documentaries. This Is It. I saw it a couple times. Actually, I saw it even once more after we talked in Las Vegas about it. And I want to bring those parts up and put your thinking cap on, because when we come back on segment number four, which I can't believe has already blown back the first hour, but I want to talk about to the drummers out there also. When I asked you at the restaurant about your love affair or your hate with the word click track, and you know, and it's the word click track, you know, you love it or you hate it, and you explained to me and expressed to me that you love it. And I want to talk about a story that you shared with me between Michael and Michael Bearden, the musical director at that time on the This Is It tour. And I'll talk to you on the break about what we talked about, just to refresh your memory. So you guys, you know, again, we're going on the second hour of a 2-hour interview with my in-studio guest, the iconic and the amazing, the sweetheart, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. And Jonathan, you sound great, man, even though you got this bronchitis. So we're doing this, man. We're gonna get you some more short-winded on these next questions. So with that said, everybody, I want you to stick around, and I want you to be amazed like I am. I mean, I'm literally amazed that we are actually having this interview. As I said before, we wanted to do this on August 29th, Michael's actual birthday. But because of situations, we weren't able to do so. It was definitely, Jonathan, worth the wait. And I'm so proud and I'm privileged to have you do this, man. My hat's off to you. So with that said, trailing out of segment number three into segment number four, the second hour of a 2-hour interview with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett from the who's who of the industry. So you guys don't go anywhere. Stick around. Segment number four, we're going to pick it up where we left off. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove. Stay tuned.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al DiMeola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one-song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Enter Talk Radio, your in to all things music.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Everybody, welcome back. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, segment number four, brought to you by the InterTalk Radio Network with my in-studio guest, the iconic and legendary drummer, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Jonathan, let me do a little bit of business before we continue on here for a second. Guys, do yourselves a favor. If you can't listen to our shows live, do yourselves a favor and do us a favor by downloading our easy-to-use navigate application. Two words, either on iTunes or Google Play. InterTalk is the first, radio is the second. Take Jackie's Groove and all of our plethora of shows with you on the go. And I also want to take a couple of seconds to say thank you to our sponsors. Really biased to my newest sponsor, Blue Microphones. And also, too, with our dear friends of ours over at Pitbull Audio, Calvin Lee and the gang. You can reach them at pitbullaudio.com. You know what? They just want you to play it loud. And somebody I'm sure Jonathan and myself, I know I'm very familiar with, and Jonathan is too, Studio Instrument Rentals, sir-usa.com for all of your backline needs. And all of your Herschel studio needs. And I also want to say hello to Jonathan's drum company of choice, DW Drum Workshop Incorporated, John Good and Don Lombardi and all the gang over there. And people who I'm real biased to myself, my drumstick company for the past 22 years, Vader Percussion. You can reach them at Vader, VATR.com. And people that I'm most biased to. Going on 27 years with my drum company, Latin Percussion, LPMusicGroup.com, Terry, Derek, John, Don, and Jerry, and all my boys, and Derek Zimmerman. I'm going to say it over and over again. Thank you for your belief. Visit them at lpmusic.com. Okay, now, long-winded stories are over with. Back to Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Jonathan, I have to ask you this question because I didn't ask you this back in Las Vegas, but I have a lot of people that I've been blessed to work with, but I still am starstruck. Can you share with me and the listeners when you were with Michael? I don't care if it was just hanging out or if it was in rehearsal or on stage. Was there a certain time, was there a certain switch that clicked and you realized the fact that he was not only your friend and your brother, but he's still Michael Jackson? Did that still always affect you that you were hanging out with the greatest entertainer of all time? Or was he just a brother to you?
You want me to be honest?
Please.
To be honest, I just felt like he was my brother. I never looked at. I knew what he was, who he was.
Right.
I knew the regard he had in the industry and in the world. But when I was with him and when I worked with him, I knew he was my boss, first of all, and I knew that. I knew he was my family, like my family. I knew he was my friend, and I looked at him. I looked at him like I just want to please this man because he has trust and faith in me by bringing me on board and giving me the engine room seat. You know, above everybody else that wanted. So I have great regard for that respect and that honor. and that trust and faith he has in me. So I do everything in my being that I can live up to that trust and be beyond, play and perform beyond that trust. So like he was doing, like he wanted to bring me back the next time, like he always wanted me. So, and but I didn't think of him like as the mega star. I knew he was that. That wasn't the first and foremost thing in my mind. In my mind, he was like my family. You know, I'd been with him before he became the megastar. You got to remember, when I got with him on the Destiny tour, he wasn't the megastar.
Right.
You know, I saw the moth. I was doing the whole period of time when moth became a butterfly, the transition from that. So I looked at him as I looked at him when I got with him. And I saw the magnitude of what he had achieved, and when he and I had talked about what he wanted to do and become exactly what he did. But I still didn't, for some reason, didn't regard it as Michael the mega star or the superstar, which I knew, of course, in mindset, I knew what that was, but I didn't really live by that. I lived by him being my friend, my brother in heart and spirit, and my boss, who I need to please, you know, I want to please, you know, and it wasn't in a pressure way. I never had pressure with Michael. So the way that I want to make him happy, I want to make him smile when I play, I want to make him feel it, I want to make him want to dance, you know, I want to touch and move his spirit that he danced way beyond he expected to do on every given show. And that's what I tried and strove to do. And I tried to do was to make him feel what I was feeling through the beauty and the glory of his music. So, and that's what I was doing all the time. So I regarded him as more as a friend and a brother, somebody that's in my life as a partner. Like I call him, tell everybody he's like my dance partner, my beat to his feet. So
that's a beautiful thing, man. You know, and there's some things I won't touch on, the mechanics and stuff that we talked about, but I just want to say it from my heart to, you know, from what you shared with me, to the people out there that falsely accuse Mr. Jackson of all this erroneous, excuse my French, shit that was brought to the table. Shame on you. You know, karma is a bitch, and it's going to come back tenfold. And I don't know Michael personally, but just through you, I felt like I knew him from growing up with him. And I think it's absolutely just ridiculous. And it's a shame. Shame on you people. So that's my soapbox. Let me step back off of that. You know, I want to share something with you. A friend of mine, Donnie Osmond, we saw Donnie in Las Vegas, and he shared a great story because he had a lot of pictures. A lot of people don't realize the fact out there, if you are from the vein of African-American or Caucasian, you know, we had the Osmond brothers, and we also had the Jacksons growing up. But a lot of people don't understand out there, one of Michael's biggest hits was a song called Ben, a song about a rat. And that song, if people don't realize that out there and don't know, let me educate you, that song was actually supposed to have been recorded by Donny Osmond. And Donny could not do it because he was on the road. So he said, you know what? Give the song to my friend Michael Jackson. And Donny says on stage, the music behind him stops and he goes, and that's the last time I ever gave away a song. Because the song turned out to be a massive hit for Michael. But you think about two young guys out there with the heartthrob of America and the world. You had two guys out there with number one hits. One about a rat called Ben and another song called Puppy Love by Donny Osmond. So, I mean, these are these little great little things that you learn about. And that whole situation of Michael, I mean, being friends with JR and the music of Ron Tepperton and everything that was written behind that Michael. I even heard an actual track of Michael a cappella of Thriller, which was just a mind blower. And Jonathan, share with the audience out there, share how intense your sound checks were with Michael, how he was not the star that hung off backstage. Tell everybody out there what you told me, how he was in there trenching through everything with you guys to make sure that song and that music for the audience was on point. Share with us.
Yeah, Michael was a very meticulous person, artist, and very particular about everything. He knew his music. He knew every nuance of it. He had a vision of the tour before the tour actually formulated. So he knew how he wanted the staging and everything to go with every song. So he wanted to know how he knew how the accents were supposed to go and with every song and what he wanted accentuated. So we do sound checks to be just like we do on the whole show. We have to do it like we did the show. He wouldn't go through every song, but he'd pick certain songs each time. But he was very meticulous about the staging and placement of the dancers, you know, positions and of the music. And him and Brad would work out what he wants. We're here, and you happen to hear it there in the songs and events. But he was mindful of every aspect of it, you know, because he wanted to get his audience and his fans to get the biggest and the greatest experience of his live performance of his songs. He said, which is my fans know my music, and I wanted to sound just like the record. So he's a stickler for everything, visuals as well as audible, and rehearsals and the sound checks and everything. So, you know, he's one of the artists, and that being that way is what got him to the level that he's at now, was known to be at.
Right.
So by being that way, everything mattered to him, you know. So he just very, very mindful and particular artist that wanted everything to be perfection. Perfection was his key word. He always was say that word a lot. I want perfection.
Well, it showed.
We try to give.
I mean, it definitely showed over the years, you know. And I look at Michael, you know, like during rehearsals and so on. You know, he parallels that of our dear friend of the studio and the network, Mr. Al Jarreau, who, by the way, Al has announced his retirement from the music industry today, guys. We'll talk about that
more.
Yeah, he's due to health reasons. He's just said it's not fun anymore. So I read about that today, and I will confirm that with his management. But Godspeed, Al, and Godspeed for your continued recovery of your health issues. We all have them. So, but the reason why I brought that up is that when you listen to Michael with the band, Michael is a true walking and breathing beatbox. The man has got more rhythm in his pinky that most would be blessed with in their whole body. And, you know, and watching him orchestrate the band and talk about the parts via mouth were, to me, just short of genius. You know, and Jonathan, when you told us about, you know, the This Is It tour, you had mentioned to me about the time where the media made it sound that Michael was in bad health. But in reality, Michael was in better health than people that were half his age at the time during the rehearsals of This Is It. And, you know, and it showed that. And with that said, I remember you told me the size of this tour, This Is It. You mentioned to me about those two huge Russian transport planes and all the equipment.
Antonov.
Tell the audience about how enormous this 50 show tour was going to be. This Is It.
When you saw them, when you see the movie, This Is It. Basically, you're seeing only about 75% of the show that you were going to be seeing was going to be presented. There's so many aspects that didn't get to be seen or known by the public that, you know, that never got to be revealed. A lot of things were going to be revealed the next week at our rehearsals. They had paid $1 million to David Copperfield, I believe it was, to do a magic show, some kind of magic disappearance or whatever it was. We never got to know, because when I asked AEG's production manager, asked him to tell me, I'm like Michael's brother, I'm like family. He said, yeah, I know that. He would be laughing. I said, you can tell me, I'm not going to tell anybody. I was trying to get out of here. He's like laughing. Like, he said, no, Sugarfoot,
right.
I'm not even going to tell you. It's a secret. You have to wait just like everybody else to see it next week. So I have a day or two before he died. So there were so many things, you know, was going to be happening. There was supposed to be all the arenas going to be decorated like a rainforest, inside and outside, and with the rain sound coming. You know, you hear the rainforest, clay storming, and thunder and everything. So the ushers in the parking lot and the ushers inside was going to be like Cirque du Soleil performers dressed up, you know, in costumes and stilts and all kind of things. You know, the parking lot even. You know, they would escort people where to park, and, you know, all the people that you see at concerts as in normal clothing or uniform clothing, like a security clothing, they were going to be selected and be in actual costumes as part of the show. So as soon as you pull into the premises, into the lot of the arena, you are in the show. Not when you get in the arena, but when you pull into the premises of the parking area, the show had begun. You know, people would be all over with, you know, like I say, with costumes and stuff, and escort you. So when you go to the door, you walk into the arena, and in the hallways and lobbies of the arena, there's going to be people in costumes, and like I said, the rainforest sounds and foliage everywhere. This is what somebody explained to me. It was supposed to happen. And inside the arena, there's going to be foliage everywhere, and people on stilts and all kind of different costumes, and usher you to your seats, and, you know, and ghostly kind of things like for Thriller.
Right.
It was going to be amazing. It was going to be a huge production, really amazing. So, unfortunately, we got cheated out of that by what happened. And it was going to be a legacy tour, because Michael said that was his last one. So he wanted to be great. and the biggest one he's done, or the best one he's done. And it was going to be the first time his kids got to see him be who he, you know, they didn't understand who he was because they were so young. But he wanted, he really wanted this one so his children could see who he was and find out who their dad is. Because, you know, sometimes the kids didn't understand why everybody making such a fuss over him. But when they would have seen the magnitude of the people, the adoration from their dad and the magnitude of what he does on stage, they would understand who this is my dad. I can't believe it.
Right.
But they would get a grasp on who he was.
You answer this question, and if you want to share, was Michael's swan song?
Yes, it was.
Okay.
He said he wanted to do this one more.
What a shame.
And that would be it. He wanted to get into film. He wanted to get into film and making motion picture movies and stuff. So he was trying to transition into that, you know. Not to say that he would never record again or whatever, but
right.
I think he was kind of burnt on touring. Touring is such a grueling thing. People don't understand. Touring is just such a grueling, draining kind of experience, you know.
The only fame is when the lights go on. That's it. The only fame is when the lights go on. You know, that
that's what they know.
To hurry up and wait. You know, and that's, I know that from a fact. It's a situation. There's nothing glamorous about the touring music business. It's all on top. And we have to give credit and kudos to our techs because they're there before we are. They're there with us and they're there after we leave. And it just takes so much, and the enormity of this is it would have been just an absolute mind blower. You know, and Jonathan, in the last minute and 39 seconds, actually, I'm going to hold that thought. I want you to think about this on the next segment. I always ask this to the musicians, either recorded and or live, but I want to find out what songs were your favorite songs to perform with the entertainers that you've been blessed to work with. And I think the listeners want to know. I'm curious. I'd like to find out exactly what songs, and if there were any songs at all that you didn't want to play or didn't really look forward to playing, that if you didn't, then of course the audience would lynch you guys on the way out. So, I mean, there's a plethora of songs, hits that are known worldwide that you've had the ability to bless yourself live on those. So when we come back on the next segment, let's talk about that. Let's talk about, you know, what it takes for Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett to get prepared for a show on a smaller venue or a show on a bigger venue, what you like to do, what you don't like to do, what is taboo and what is welcome. So let's kind of let everybody kind of walk in your shoes for the next two segments and kind of make them feel like they're part of the Jonathan Sugarfoot legacy. So with that said, everybody stick around. If again, questions, ask us, download our app, InterTalk Radio on Google Play and also on iTunes. So with that said, guys, don't go anywhere. Please bring the questions up. I've got a stack full of paperwork and questions on my desk that I'm not even going to be able to scratch with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. So with that said, guys, don't go anywhere. Go grab yourself a nice little drink itself, maybe a cocktail if it's at lunch or a bite to eat. But you don't want to miss the last two segments here on Jackie's Groove. This is Jackie Bertone brought to you by the almighty InterTalk Radio Network. Guys, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after this short break. Music, maestro, there it is. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on Intertalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday at 2 p.m.
Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Heartbreak Hotel, Mr. Michael Jackson. Guys, Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, Intertalk Radio Network, segment number 5. We're heading out, guys. We got one more segment after this. You know, your fiance had said something on break, and she wanted me, or she wanted you to mention something. Go ahead and tell the audience what she wanted us to know about.
Yeah, she mentioned that, to mention that I was one of the last people to see Michael before he died. I left that night before he congratulated everybody and a good job, well done. And then he afterwards he came to me special and gave me a big hug and he said, "You're doing a great job for, you know, great job. You sound great and it's gonna be wonderful. It's gonna be incredible, huh?" And I said, "Yes, it's gonna be incredible." He said, I can't wait. I'm so excited, everything coming together." He said, "I'm starting to get the whole vision of how it's gonna go, and it's gonna be wonderful." He said, "I can't wait for tomorrow." He said, "I can't wait till tomorrow. We start pick up where we left off." Little did I know, you know, that there wasn't going to be no tomorrow. And so I got to hug him and say, "Okay, he said, okay, I love you, Foot." And I said, I love you, Mike." He said, "Okay, see you tomorrow. I can't wait. It's going to be great." I said, "Okay, I'll see you tomorrow." And I didn't know that was going to be my last hug from him, or last time I saw him alive. You know, who knows? That was a night 9 hours before they said he passed away, about 1:30 in the morning. And it said that. They said that he actually passed around 9 something in the morning, not 2, as they reported at the hospital. Right. He was long before, so I was estimating about 9 hours before I gave him a hug, and he was alive and breathing, able to tell me he loved me, and he's excited, and he can't wait until tomorrow rehearsals. Little did he know there would be no tomorrow. Little did I know. I would never see him again. There would be no tomorrow. It's heartbreaking. Still, as I recite this, it's devastating.
Tell the listeners, and I'm sorry for your loss, tell the listeners how long it took you to pick up your drumsticks again after the news of Michael's passing.
Well, you know, Cameo has been kind of my mainstay for 35 years. And in between all other things I did, I get a call back from, they would chase my schedule around and follow. And they said, "We see you finished with that. You ready to come back home?" All the time. So after Michael died, they called me to give the condolences and stuff. "Do you want to come back to work with us?" And they say, "I know it's going to be hard for you. I understand if you can." I told him I couldn't. So Michael passed on in June. And I just had the wrong mindset. I just could not think right. I was really messed up. You know, nervous breakdown, all that stuff. And I was just messed up. And I couldn't see myself working or pull myself together to work. And it wasn't until November. I started feeling a sense I got to get back to work. I called Cameo and I told him, "Look, I'm ready to come back to work finally." And he was so happy and stuff. So I wound up, you know, like they say, you got to get back on that horse, you know.
took me a while, but I got back on the horse in November of 2009 and got back with Cameo and worked with them until I got the call for the Cirque du Soleil Michael Jackson Immortal Tour. And it started that August 1st of 2011. And that carried through to September 1st of 2014. Then, I mean, two weeks before Cirque tour ended, I got a call again from Catherine, the agent for Cameo. And she said, "Johnny, we see that you're finishing up in a couple of weeks. Are you ready to come back home?" I said, "Yes, I'm ready to come back home, Catherine. I'm ready to come back home." She said, "Oh, great. Larry will be happy. Larry Blackman, lead of Cameo. He'll be really happy. Okay, great." So by the middle of September, I got back with Cameo. It was really cool. I've been back with them since.
You know,
that's my second home, too.
You know, last year, Jonathan, I hosted a show with a great Latin Peruvian timbale player by the name of Tony Sukar, who has an award-winning show called Unity. It's a Latin tribute to Michael Jackson, and I'm thankful, and he's thankful that you actually surprised him by coming on the show. And, you know, I want to give kudos to everybody, the musicians, that are keeping Michael's spirit alive. Because every time we play him Michael Jackson, you know, music, we are breathing life back into him. And I know you believe that wholeheartedly. You know, I personally don't think there's going to ever be an entertainer that'll even come close to Michael's talent. And with that said, you know, on stage, I want you to ask yourself a question. And I asked this a second ago before we left on the break. Think really hard for a second, Sugar. Was there a song that you could not wait to play if you had to choose only one song to play with Michael Jackson? What song would that be?
You asked me one of the most difficult questions you could ever ask me. Because all my music, I love, but there were some particular ones, you know. Because of the drum beats on some of Michael's music, so intricate and so challenging and so great, and like powerhouse in steam engines. Right. Like, I want to be starting something with, because I love that beat. You know, I love playing that beat because it's, you know, for me it's easy, but it moves so much with the rhythm, percolating rhythm going through. You know, same thing as in the second song would be Working Day and Night. Same thing as continuous beat, just chugging like a steam engine down the tracks, you know, and Working Day and Night. I love those kind of challenging songs because you have to have energy and intensity the whole song from the very first downbeat to the end. And I love those kind of things, you know, those kind of songs, I should say. But Michael has so many iconic songs and they're all fun to play. Thanks to, like you say, once again, JR, and Jeff Porcaro and Dougal. And they're like, they put some amazing templates of things for me to follow in and to build upon. You know, so and all the songs Michael did was so fantastic. You know, and for a drummer, because Michael, like you said, rhythm is exudes from his body and his spirit. So for a drummer, it's a great partnership to have me with an artist like that. So I was very fortunate. And I enjoyed working with Michael because we were on the same spirit line, and I understood what he wanted, what he needed, and I could relate to that because I feel like I was on the same spiritual line as him. So of course I knew it. I felt it. I could give it and deliver it. And he would look at me sometimes, he wonder how I did this, how I did that, how I knew he was going to do this and that. Because we was tapped into the same spiritual line. And it showed through our artistry and our work together that we were meant to be together. We were meant to be a couple, a musician couple, an artist couple, and a dance partner, you know, because he was on dance and I was on beats that dance needs to dance for and to. So we both were rhythm partners. And it was a wonderful experience. I would never be the same because nobody else relate to that like Michael did and I. It was a special, special thing, you know. That was Camelot for me. Michael was Camelot. His organization was Camelot. And I felt like I was with the real king of performing and of entertainment and showmanship, you know. He was especially special to me to perform with as a drummer.
And let me ask you this question, Tulsa, too. Let's talk about on stage with Michael. Let's talk about the actual sound check and getting everything in. Listen to the young listeners out there, even the veterans out there. What did Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett have in his mix? When you were on stage live, what did you have coming through your wedges that you definitely had to have that during a show? And what, on the other side of the coin, what didn't you want to hear in your wedges? Share with us that.
Okay, I'm going to step you down through my mix when I go on stage, especially when I have speakers and everything. Okay, and first of all, I got to hear my drums loud and powerful. Most people cannot listen to my headphone mix or be by the speakers behind them, because I tell you, I listen at death-defying levels, because it's not that I want to hear it loud, it's that it's got to ignite and trigger my spirit. You know, it's got to be, it's got to motivate me. It's got to, I got to feel it. I got to have this presence. So it's extremely loud. Most people will run away from my seat if they, when they turn their music on. So I have to hear the drums, very powerful, so I know where I am in the groove and with the song and my performance. Next thing, I have to have the sequences. There's a lot of times, you know, Michael's records are stacked so heavy and so deep. You know, Quincy Jones will have like 120, 140 tracks or 80 tracks. And it's, you know, it's impossible to do with two keyboard players and no percussion is on stage, you know, and all other aspects that's in there. So the keyboard players will do all of their performance of the parts they were assigned and learned. But there would be the extra keyboard parts that's in the sequences or bass synth lines. that Freddie would be doing. So I have drums and bass have to lock. So I have my drums predominant, then I'd have to all whatever sequences are going, the percussion, I have to settle in with it, you know, to make it feel good and make it feel right. My clock has to fall right in place as if I'm part of the sequence, and to make it feel right and good. Then I have the bass under that, step down a little bit less than volume than that, maybe 3 or 4 dB less than that. Then I have rhythm guitars, because David Williams was a rhythm master of all masters. And him and people like my cousin, Al McKay from Rhythm of the Fire, I put him on the same level, and Tony Mays from Rufus. Those are the clock masters of guitar. It's unbelievable what they can do. But David was like super precision. So I needed him in the rhythms he played added to the feel and attitude of the groove. So he was right under the bass guitar. Then I'd have a blend of both keyboards under that, maybe 3 or 4 dB under that. And of course, I'd have Michael's vocals would be right up there just under the sequences and between the sequences of the bass. So I could hear him for any directions or hear his vocal performance. So a step down that way in that order, you know, I'd have a step down. And the background vocals would be under the lead vocals. So they were there and it was important, but Michael's lead vocal was the most important thing I had to cue off. So we'll step down in that manner in order when I have my stage mix set up. And my system is via you.
And you guys had your own sound guy that traveled with you, so there wasn't any retraining needed to get that, duplicate that song or that sound concert by concert, correct?
No, we have to have the staff that was for the dedicated to the tour itself. So they knew it, and once they learned it, they had everything down, unless you gave them an adjustment to make, you know, give me a little bit more synthesized track. I can lock in better, or bass track, or whatever's on David's track, so I can lock in certain songs. David's guitar part, rhythms and parts were so iconic and unbelievable, because he played on all of those records, a lot of those records, you know. His parts were so iconic and unbelievable, I had to feel that, because it gave so much emotion to the song. Different from if it wasn't there, but it was too low in the mix. He would set my attitude a lot of times. David and I, me with another special team, we had an incredible lot together. We had so much mutual respect and love for each other. We were brothers, too, in spirit, really, really were. And that was another, people may not know, David Williams, very unfortunately, passed away 3 months before Michael did. And Michael, when he toured, he only wanted me and David. He said, I don't care who else you get. I got to have Foot, and I got to have David Williams. And so it was that year in 2009, it was a really difficult year. We had no idea what was going to come in that year. Right before we started rehearsal, a month before we got the rehearsal together, and March 6th, I'll never forget, I got the call that David was gone. And I knew that, I was shocked. I'm like, I knew that Michael would be upset. So I heard that he was very upset and distraught, because we were his team. Everybody at his camp, me, David, and Michael were the three-man team. And he had to have us with him to make the core of what was going to be there. Everything else is optional. Get what you want, who you want. But Michael made it understood that we were the core of his sound and his live sound and his vibe on stage and his the character of his music on stage. So he always demanded that we be there. And only I missed it only the times that I was under contract with somebody else. I got called for it each time, but I had to tell him I had a contract already. You know, so he was very distraught and upset about it, but. I can't, you know, you can't get out of a contract.
Right.
So, you know, I only missed a few things that I was already, I'm going to get here. But other than that, I would have been there in a heartbeat, you know, and Michael's family for me. And he's the one I wanted to really work for all the time.
You know, I remember you mentioned to us in Las Vegas how the enormity of the stage of This Is It and how Michael could not see you and wanted you to be brought up so he could be and sight line with him. So he always had that, you know, his brother on stage with that. How did that make you feel to know that he needed you and that familiar face on stage? He had to see you. How much of a difficulty was that for the crew to build a different part of that stage so he could see you?
Well, what happened was that they got a whole new team musicians together for Michael. And they were trying to, like I said, they were trying to get a whole band back. And not even have me there. They were a whole new band, a younger band and stuff for Michael. Michael insisted on having and demanded me be there. You know, they were trying to usurp, and so to speak, and get somebody else in my seat. Michael demanded and said, "I got to have Foot. I don't want nobody else but Foot." I said, "You can get anybody else in the band you want. I want nobody else but Foot on drums." So it wound turned out and worked out that I want to, you know, be his choice, and then I got on because his assistants, you know. So I got off track and I'm trying to think. What's the question again? I'm sorry.
No, the question was the fact that how he had to see you because you were, I don't want to use the term buried, but he didn't have sight line of you on that stage until he requested you to be brought up so he could see you during his performance.
Well, I was getting to the point, that's why I got sidetracked, but I get to the point that every tour, you know, Michael would always communicate me, look back and see me, so and look at me and smile. And he was like, he was drawing energy from me because I'm always smiling on stage. And he loved that. He said, "I love you smile on stage." But I didn't know it took to him that deeply and that well, that much, so to speak, that I found this out, that he had to see me on This Is It rehearsals. And that, you know, I was on the floor and I thought it was weird that they got my drums on the floor. Man, this is crazy. I'm always on some kind of riser. I didn't understand why, but the production, they didn't want to spend the money to build a stage for me. Be up high. And plus I would interfere. I don't know if you remember the staging on the movie, that ramp that goes across the back of the stage is a ramp.
Right.
And if my drums were up high, too high, my drums, top cymbals would be up in a visual aspect, but they want it clean. It would be up in that aspect of visuals. So they didn't want me to be on the riser. They put me on the floor. But Michael, a week or so before he passed, he had insisted on them building the riser. And I had no idea about this. They said, and the production manager came and said, "You know, guess what?" He kept looking at my drum set and production manager and walking around and looking and writing something down. I said, "What are you looking at me? Looking directly at me, smiling, but writing something down." "What's going on?" And he came to me and said, "You know what I was doing? I was getting measurements for you in your setup. He said, "Because Michael came to us specifically and told us, you got to put your foot on a riser. I need to see him." Now, I had no idea he had this urging or desire to see me, physically see me on stage, and that it inspired him. They say, because he said it inspires him when he looks at you on stage, he sees you. Your smile inspires him, because he always smiles, and it gives him energy, and he carries on. He reboots, in other words, he reboots himself by looking at me on stage, and then he go back out and tear up again. I didn't know that all those years. I had no clue. It never was expressed to me. But this guy, production manager, AEG, told me that. I said, "Really? You say he said that?" He said, "Yeah, so we're going to put you on a riser." He wanted like a 2-foot riser, but we can't do that because your drum set will be in the line of sight of the ramp, and we mess up our visuals for the choreography and stuff up there. But we're going to put you on a 1-foot riser. But this is why he said, "I just want to let you know this is my Michael's insistence that he wanted to see you. He needed to. He had to see you. And everything on stage, so he can get." He said you inspire him when he looks at you on stage, not only just your beat. He needs
Foot. I want you to hold that. But
he spent $10,000 on that riser.
Stay. Don't go anywhere. We're gonna trail off on 5 and 6. I've got just a bunch of questions to ask you. So when we come back, I'm gonna ask questions to Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett, Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, on the Talk Radio Network. Don't go anywhere, guys. We're gonna wrap it up in this last segment with Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Don't go anywhere.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on Intertalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element, affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Everybody, welcome back. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, brought to you by the almighty InterTalk Radio Network. Guys, again, I'm going to repeat it. I'm proud and I'm privileged to welcome into my studio today on the last segment of a two-hour interview. You know, when people say that I'm sicker than a dog, I don't know any dogs that are sick, but I'll tell you right now, the trooper that I have in my studio today, thank you, Jonathan. I know you're not feeling well, but you know what? We're going to get this last 16 minutes, and we're going to let you go back to bed here and stop making out with your fiance.
Yeah.
You know, they, you know, it'll get you sick. So, with that said,
that's hard to do.
Yeah, well, trust me. Hey, Jonathan, you know, we all have somebody by our sides that make things happen. I got to tell you, with my team over at InterTalk Radio, the CEO Florentino and the COO and my technical guru, Mr. Paul Bratesky, my boy, my girl, my producer Megan. When I couldn't do it without my team. And the bottom line is we all are, I'm thankful internally for what they do. And with that said, you know, we have a little spiel that we always do at the last part of the segment, Jonathan. I always bring on my CEO to say hi to a little bit of pertinent situations, but I need him more now than ever because if I don't stretch this right leg of mine, it's going to fall off. So with that said, Jonathan, do me a favor, say hi to Florentino. Florentino, say hi to Jonathan.
Hey, what's up, brother? How you doing, man?
I'm doing, trying to hang in there. I'm doing pretty good. Trying to hold on and get a little bit better over this flu.
Oh, man. I know. I can hear that, bro, man. You know, we've known each other for a long time, since the 80s. I met you in 87 at the NAMM show. And I have to say you know, you were just a consummate gentleman then as you are now. And, you know, it's so funny. After all these years, we've run into each other. We've talked. I've actually interviewed you on my show, The Changing Stage. I learned so much more through this interview. And I've been blessed by all the information that you've, the wealth of experience and information you've shared with all the listeners, including myself, because I was a fan today, you know, more than the CEO. And, you know, with that said, you know, you've got a great website and you've got some strong, you know, internet presence. We like all the people listening in to really kind of find out more about you. Can you give them your URLs and social media and all that other fun stuff, that a way they can go out and discover Jonathan the way that we've had a chance to?
Well, I have a great team right here. my lovely fiance Mara. She handles all my work and on the internet and stuff, and she knows all that information for me because I'm so busy in my schedule with Cameo dates and independent dates for Cameo as well. But she handles all my baby. What is all the information he's talking about? Because she's my social media reference. Yeah.
Basically, his website.
This is Myra Hisami, my lovely, beautiful.
Welcome, yeah, Myra.
We're gonna be Myra.
Hey, what's going on?
Put your mouth to the mic, girl.
His website is jmdb.world. So basically, it's like an IMDb for all of Jonathan Moffitt's work with like various artists. And it has everything Jonathan Moffett on there.
What about Twitter?
He just opened a Twitter account. So if you guys want to join, you guys feel free to. Like, if you guys have Twitter accounts. Twitter, his Facebook, his Instagram, they all have the same username. So it's J Moffett.
MJM?
MJM, yeah. So at J Moffett MJM. They're all the same. That's his official username.
Awesome.
Perfect.
Awesome.
Perfect.
Well, hey, I'm going to let you guys continue on. I know there's so much more information in such a short time. So, brother, we'll catch up soon, you know, offline, and definitely get better as quick as possible. And nice to meet you, Myra. Hopefully we'll run into you at one of these events or sometime soon.
Thank you.
All right. I am back. Thank you, Tino. Hey, brother. Jonathan, let me ask you a question, brother. And it's something I ask a lot of people. I just kind of run through this in the last segment. You know, you've inspired so many people in your life, in your career. Let me ask you this question. Who's inspired Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett musically?
As far as drummer's sake, you know, I'd have to go all the way back to the original drummers with James Brown, Gable Sparks, and Clyde Stubblefield. Mm-hmm. And there's another Melvin, I forget his name, but he's like, all the James Brown drummers, you know, inspired me. And the drummers that weren't really listed at the time were Motown and Stax Records and all those record labels that, you know, according to the popular song at the time it was, they beat right. Inspired me. Bernard Purdy was, you know, a phenomenal drummer, yet still.
Absolutely.
And he inspired me a lot. And then I started getting into rock drummers, John Bonham, you know, was inspired me, Carmen Appice. A lot of rock drummers, you know. And then I got into fusion, and then that's when Lenny White, you know, Billy Cobham, you know, a lot of great, great drummers, and Nirvana, Michael Walden, you know, big influence over me, you know. So it transitioned all through the years, you know, and I got inspired by the things they were doing. I tried to pick up what they were doing and then add my own New Orleans to it, my own attitude to it, and then expand on it by adding extra hits and breaks and syncopation here and there. So it makes it a total new gumbo, so to speak, a mix of rhythm. So I made my own rhythmic gumbo, so to speak. So since I'm from New Orleans, I can sing a gumbo. Right. But a lot of drummers inspired me. And then, of course, the pop drummers, you know, like John Robinson inspired me a lot. You know, Jeff Porcaro, inspiration. You know, Steve Ferroni is another one. You know, and that inspired me. And a lot of drummers with groups like Diamond from Ohio Players, who were huge influence on me. David Garibaldi, I have to mention, because he was he was a huge influence on me. Huge influence. I mean, really huge. But my first idol. And I understood now, I learned through reading his articles, David Garibaldi was inspired by, my first idol was my homemade, Joseph Zigaboo Modelist from at the time it was just the Meters. And Joseph Zigaboo Modelist played like no other drummer on earth played. And he had some different language, his own language he created, and I wanted to speak it, and I got into his rhythms. His playing so much, they used to call me Little Zig back in New Orleans before I left town, because I learned all the nuances of what he's done and he was doing at the time. You know, I haven't played it in so long because I can't do it exactly like I used to do it. I was very, very meticulous on parts and attitude and swing, the swing of a beat, and so I had it really, really down. But I would have to say it's my very first idol. And that inspired me and made me really get really enthusiastically and involved in trying to up my game, so to speak, come out with a new language and stuff. Because Joseph Zigaboo Modelist is unbelievable. Whoever's out there, you have to find his work. Listen to his playing on record. He plays on the record like he plays live. It's unbelievable the way he intermixed rhythms and syncopation on all elements of the drum set. And then David Garibaldi plays the way he does. He said in his article, from listening to Zigaboo, he called it Zigaboo, of course, Joseph Modelist. So several of us were inspired by each other. But those are just a number of influences.
And speaking of David Garibaldi, I just talked to David yesterday. So listeners out there, David's doing great. He's at home after his unfortunate situation last month when he was struck by an Amtrak train in Oakland. He is on the mend. Herman Matthews is covering his duties right now back on the drum throne. And David told me to tell the listeners out there he'll be back very, very, very soon. So God is great, brother. David, get strong. And I can't tell you, Jonathan, he's inspired me as a percussionist. And I'm going to ask you, I'm going to tell you something, brother. I have been blessed to have worked with the greatest drummers. aforementioned Jeff Porcaro, Vinnie Cailuta. I've been, you know, J.R. Robinson. But I got to tell you something, brother. My bucket list is empty when it comes to me having anything to do with Sugarfoot. So if God blesses us somewhere down the line, man, I got to play with you either recording or live. That would be a bucket list thing for me to check off. You know, I've got to put that on my itinerary. And so if it's meant to be, you and I will share the stage or sue the studio again or a studio once so I can put that on my bucket list. And speaking of bucket list, let me ask this question. You've done everything. But if someone was to say to Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett, what is your first thing right now on your bucket list before the good Lord brings you home? What do you want that to be?
To get my own personal music out to the world and to see how many people relate to what I have to say musically of my own. I've been supporting all the countless artists and recording artists and stars all my career, 38 years of my life, but I've yet to put on my own music and get it recognized and known. So I'm working on stuff right now and I'm trying to get it out there and see how many people. The most important thing, the record sales is great. You know, that means people like your music. But the most important thing is how many people relate to what you have to say and how you say it musically. So it's artistry that you come with, that how many people feel that and relate to it. You know, that's sort of, in a way it's a challenge, but in a way it can be disappointing sometimes, but it can be gratification. But I want to see what people think about what I think, because in the lyrical content, especially the innermost feelings and thoughts are enclosed in your lyrical contents, and people will get to know who you are as a writer. And I want people to want to see people can relate to who I am as a writer, a songwriter, and producer. So I want to start doing more of that now. You know, I've done the touring thing in 38 years. I've done 25 tours in 38 years. And, you know, not that I want to hang up put away my luggage right now or hang up my sticks. I'll always play. As long as I feel capable of playing, I will play. But I want to do some things more in the production field, like all the other iconic artists, like Maurice White, like Pharrell, like Timbaland, you know, like all the drummers that turn producers and writers. You know, I want to transition to that, Noah, but I'll always play. You'll see me doing clinics or live stream clinics in my studio. You'll see me playing on my records or on other people's records and things like that. If it's a right big tour, I'll do it. But other than that, I'll be selective as to when I'll go out live and do tours anymore. I've done it for a long, long time. Living out of a suitcase can get really, really taxing. Trust you know, and moving every single day, every other day is kind of very taxing. That's what the public we talked about earlier doesn't know. It's a very difficult life. There is no set hours in anything you do any given day. So you don't have the comfort of living a normal life. And you don't sleep in your own bed. You're sleeping in foreign beds all over the world.
Right.
Where you wish you, some nights you wish I had your own bed, you know. So I'd like to do one more tour, big tour, and I really want to transition into being a producer and writer and working on my book project, my coffee table book, you know, oversized coffee table book. I want to get that even more going. And I like to do, people surprised that in 38 years, I've never done a drum video. I would love to do a drum video, show my skills and my techniques, my style. I've never got to do one. So that's one thing I like to do, you know, and to have people transcribe my patterns, the sets of patterns for drum books. And there's several things that I haven't accomplished just yet in the drumming world.
If we can help you out, a dear friend of the studio and the good friend of ours that's coming up on a segment here, probably in the next month or so, Rob Wallace, who is the CEO of Hudson Music, one of the innovators of, you know, of recorded drum lessons. And if you want us to help you out that way, we'll definitely extend the olive branch. And if you'd also give us the opportunity, once Sugarfoot's got new music out, if you would give us the benefit and the pleasure of helping you promote this via our network and Jackie's Groove, it would be our absolute honor to help you out there. you know, so we're here.
Fortunate for me.
No, go ahead.
what's fortunate for me, very fortunate for me, is that in that 38-year career, I've got to sit behind some of the greatest hit makers in the world, in the history of music, and know and get to learn the formula. So I feel I have the formula, and I know how hit records are made. I know the premise of hit records, and I know what it takes to have a hit record. And so I'm feeling like really enthusiastic about that, that I have the tools next to bring that, tools among, on my belt to bring that forth and bring hit music to the audience and to the world. So, and commerciality, I should say. So that's why I'm excited about it. So people can hear my expression and who I am as an artist, a solo artist myself. So I'm excited about it.
Sugarfoot, let me ask you this question. Talked about Michael's untimely passing and how close you guys were. But I'm curious. I didn't ask this question when we were in Vegas, but I'm going to ask it now. If Michael was alive right now and you knew tomorrow was his last day on earth, what would you tell Michael, or what would you ask Michael if you had that opportunity right now?
I would say and plead to him, don't go. Don't leave me here by myself. Mm-hmm. Don't do this to me. If there's any way you can get out of that contract or that deal being your last day, please do so. Don't leave me. I need
you. His responsibility. What would he say back to you? Do you think, as close as you were?
It's according to what his circumstances was, why he had to go, why he had to leave, what the health reasons or other reasons would be, as to how he would respond. Only he can respond to that question. Right. I couldn't respond to it. All I know is what I just mentioned. I would feel and would say, why would you leave me like this? How could you do me this? That's what I felt when he left. That's what broke my spirit. You know, I need you here. I want you here. I don't want you to go. Why would you do that? How could you let that happen? I mean, just the fact, not that what happened to him actually, but the fact that he would leave me and go. Just that in itself. How could you do that to me? Knowing that he didn't have any power over it, but still I would have that question. Right. Why would you leave me by myself? You know, we're a team. How can you leave your teammate? How can you do this to me? Leave me alone. What am I going to do without you? I'm going to miss you. Let me miss you like this. What's going to do? Why won't you do that to me? It hurts, of course. And I said, please don't go.
That's deep. You know, Michael, depending on your faith out there, I know he's smiling down upon you, my brother. And he will, every time you pick up those sticks, I want that infamous groove, that drum lick of Billie Jean, just to permeate through your soul, you know. And for the listeners out there in this last minute, do yourselves a favor and go on to Facebook and look at these instructional videos that Jonathan has put up, and learn from the old guys. You know, obviously we're still working for a reason. We've cemented our names and our roots in the music business. And again, pay homage to those who have made a living doing so. With that said, Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett, brother, thank you from the bottom of my heart, the bottom of the network's heart. Thank you for, next time we'll see each other, we'll be sitting down in Vegas with that big old bowl of Benihana salad with the sauce that you put on top of it. Man, that was amazing. So with that said, everybody, please, applause, standing ovation for the most iconic drummer in the industry, in my personal opinion, Mr. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffett. Jonathan, God bless you, brother. Godspeed. Get good health. And we will see each other down the term. So everybody, say goodbye to Jonathan. This is Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, from the Intertalk Radio Network. You guys, always, I finish up by saying peace through music. Love you, Jonathan. Godspeed.
Love you, too.
Peace.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al DiMeola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time, or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one-song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.